If you're a regular listener to this programme, you'll know how irritated I get about the fate of the live music circuit at the moment. Well, particularly as important small venues continue to shut or are threatened with closure. We just lost the Cellar in Oxford. The Heavenly Social is under threat. I mean, these places which are the heart of our musical communities. But as it turns out, this is an issue which is now being discussed more widely. In fact, as we arrived back from South by Southwest last week, the DCMS Committee, the Digital Culture, Media and Sport Committee, issued a report which dealt with some of the issues facing live music in this country. A report which Michael Duggar, who we spoke to, the CEO of UK Music, who we spoke to at South by Southwest the other week, he described this report as a wake-up call for everyone who wants to safeguard live music. So to explain the findings of this report, and specifically to talk about, because it covers many aspects of live music, but specifically for starters to talk about the foundations of live music in the UK, we're joined by Mark David, who's the founder and CEO of the Music Venue Trust, which supports and campaigns on behalf of grassroots live music, and MP Damian Collins, chairman of the DCMS committee, overseeing the report which was published on Tuesday. Mr. Collins, thank you very much. We really appreciate you making time for us. I know it's hard to summarise such a thorough report because it's over 40 pages long, but there is a key line which I think opens the conclusions, which says live music is a valuable and vibrant part of the UK's culture. However, we cannot take its past success for granted and must safeguard the industry and spread its benefits more evenly, which does suggest that from the submissions that you received, that the committee is aware that live music is facing a number of problems, that live music venues, especially the smaller ones, they're facing quite a challenging time, aren't they?
Absolutely. Because some people would look at the UK music scene and see the success of people like Ed Sheeran and the success of the major festivals and think, well, it looks like it's a pretty healthy state. But when you look at the grassroots level and you say, well, where are the new acts coming from? Where's the new talent? How easy is it to get into the industry? How easy is it to have a career as a performing artist, certainly when you're starting out and if you haven't got some other money behind you? Mm. And all the indicators suggest that this is where the problem is there are fewer spaces to perform, it's harder to make a living doing it, smaller amounts or declining amounts of rehearsal space and performance space. And if we need to take this seriously because this is affecting the future of the industry, the future stars. And if we don't get this right, we will miss out on some of that talent.
And from the people you spoke to from representing various grassroots venues, because it, as I say, it's a very thorough report. I noticed one of the quotes in the report comes from one of our new friends at the Fulford Arms in York, for instance, mm. which was one of the venues we visited on Independent Venue Week this year. But from these grassroots venues, the voices from the venues or people representing the venues, what were their biggest concerns to the committee?
Well, there are a number of issues that people raise. Obviously, finance for the venues is a key thing. And one of the issues that came up many times was the question of large business rates bills being charged against venues. Mm. Venues can take up quite a lot of physical space, but the money they make or the profit they make is often very small. And to get a big rates bill, that's been enough to push some of those venues under. And so I think we need to look again at the way taxes are levied against music venues to take account of their cultural importance, but also... because the fact that they're not necessarily very sort of big profitable businesses. Mm. The other thing is, I think, for the music industry are things like production tax credits. Now, these have been deployed incredibly successfully across the creative industries. So if you're a video games maker and designer, if you work in film and television, then you get production tax credits. If you're an orchestra, you get production tax credits to help you tour and to cover many of your costs. Well, we don't have similar tax credits available for other genres of music. And mm. I think we question why that is, because, again, putting on running a tour can be very expensive. The margins are very tight. We recognise in theatre and orchestras that's the case. But why not in music too? I think the final thing I'll pick on is I also think sort of investment in grassroots music scene. And we're throwing down a challenge there for the Arts Council, which seeks to support a whole range of cultural initiatives in the country, but could they do more to support the grassroots music scene? And also a bit of a challenge for the industry, and this is one of the many things we agree with the Music Venues Trust on, is if you look at, say, something like football. In football, and we have lots of criticism of, does the Premier League reinvest enough money back in the grassroots? But you look at football and think the Premier League and the Football Association, in partnership with the government, have a very substantial fund that invests in grassroots community facilities. And then in addition to that, the clubs in the top three divisions, they pay entirely for talent identification and training for young players from the age of 8 to 18. Now, I'm not saying that that system should be replicated in the music industry, but maybe some of the big players in the industry should look at this and say they ultimately make a lot of money out of talent when it emerges and the audience that it creates. Is there more the industry could do as well, working in partnership with public bodies to try and get more money and to support developing artists, grassroots venues and rehearsal spaces?
Can I just very quickly, just before I go to Mark, sorry to sound naive, for people who don't know, including myself, what's a production tax credit?
So the way the tax credits work is you can recoup some of your investment in a project off of the taxes that you pay. So you can make quite a big saving in your tax bill, and therefore that helps to fund the work that you do. And what we found in other sectors is that the tax credit stimulates more production. So rather than it just being a subsidy from the government, actually it expands the industry. More people invest in creating more new stuff because it's more affordable to do.
I'll bring in Mark from the Music Venue Trust, and here obviously I have to declare an interest because I'm an unpaid patron of the Music Venue Trust. But Mark, the Music Venue Trust has an emergency response team which has been set up to help venues that are under threat. How many venues are you working with at the moment? Is the emergency response team working with at the moment?
Well, it's one new venue every day at the moment, which is obviously rather depressing. But last year we worked with 52. So far this year, we've already worked with 27. All the problems that Damien has just described, you know, that are highlighted in this report are driving the emergency response team quite mad. I think it's really important, though, that it's so unusual to hear somebody so informed, an MP. I normally spend a lot of my time criticising MPs, but in this particular case, Steve, I have to say, congratulations to Damien and to that whole committee. I really feel that the report has given an incredibly in-depth hearing to venues themselves and to artists, and that we finally have a real cross-party report that people can act on. It describes exactly what needs to be done. So what you're mainly hearing from me today is a big round of applause.
Because, I mean, one of the things, I mean, you obviously share some of the, you share a similar outlook on what's behind the threats of closure. Business rates is one of those things that you've been saying. It's haunting. Licensing restrictions is something. And just funding, because I know you particularly, Mark, have been asking for various arts organisations to treat you like some of the other artistic venues around the country.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, what's happened with this report is that I think it's been very clever in addressing the three aspects of the kind of key stakeholders of what's happening to our grassroots music venues, and that's the government, who should be worried about the communities and worried about the development of new talent, the cultural sector, the people you were talking about, the Arts Councils of England, Wales, Scotland, the Creative Scotland, Arts Council Northern Ireland, and also the music industry. And I think, you know, the issue is that everybody's now been challenged by this report, and we hope that everybody will finally read this and think, okay, here is a really reasonable argument. You heard some of it there from Damien. You know, when Ed Sheeran's playing 18 stadiums, a tiny amount of money could be going into support grassroots venues. Very little difference would happen to any of the people involved, but that would make all the difference, you know. And we always talk about Ed Sheeran because he's such a success story at the moment, but he played 366 shows at this level. 150 of those shows happened in venues that are now closed. That's got to be something we can do something about.
And Damien, I mean, there's a very bold statement in the report which claims that the government has not acted promptly enough to stem the tide of these closures, which have been happening at a rate unprecedented in other cultural sectors for more than 10 years. So I haven't got to grips with this, and it's not just the present government, this has been going on for some time. So can you summarise what you're suggesting or recommending when it comes to the plight of these smaller venues, which obviously not only just nurture talent, but bring in a few quid's worth of valuable kebab money into the local community as well. What your recommendations are from this report?
Sure, but I mean, there's one area where there has been some progress made, and that's on reform to planning law as well, because the planning law was being used to close down venues. You know, the nature of town centres or urban centres has changed. People often found themselves living next door to a music venue, not liking it, and applying for sort of a change in the licence to close the venue down. Now, the law's been changed on that, so that's one step in the right direction. The main issue is funding, and recognising that actually live performance spaces are really important to the music industry, but they're also cultural assets that the community values as well. So we should be looking at ways of taking some of that financial pressure off. I think looking again at business rates and the way business rates are levied on music venues, I think is a key thing. And then looking at how we can use either tax breaks or direct cultural support funds to actually get more money into the grassroots of the music industry.
You mentioned as well setting up regional music boards. I think there's one which has already been set up or is in the planning stages in Liverpool. The regional music board would be who, and what sort of clout would they have?
Well, I think they could be a combination of leaders within the music scene within that region, as well as, you know, people from local government, from the local enterprise partnerships, which often have cultural strategies but may not necessarily include music as part of that. So it'd be a combination of people that know about, who are senior, recognised senior figures within the sector within that region, and other people that sit on bodies and boards that have got the power to help. And that would be but the idea would be to actually say we should have a strategy for music as part of a cultural strategy in these big regions, you know, in these big city regions where there's a metropolitan mayor, and that someone is, you know, has to put that strategy together and be accountable for that being delivered. I think we've reached these sorts of, I think, watershed moments in other sectors in the past where we say there's a problem here that if we don't do something about, you know, we will be in a much worse place very quickly, and one that could be difficult to recover from. And we certainly felt that the crisis in the shrinking state of the live music scene is really important. And I think I think something else that came through really clearly from some of the artists, Xiao Do, the grime artist, he said to us that, you know, actually for a young performer, yes, you can try and grow an audience on YouTube and by, you know, and streaming your music, but actually you need to develop as a performer, performing in front of people, and it's also a way in which you make a little bit of money to try and subsidise your work, you know, through ticket sales, through merchandise sales, through selling discs and records. I mean, that's you know, that's an important part of a performer's development. And if there aren't the spaces available where they can perform, then many people will have to quit music altogether.
I think there's some good points there, particularly where we've got to and that sort of watershed moment, because Mark, we're running out of time, aren't we, in some cases? Some venues, these things can't happen quickly enough. Any of the suggestions in this report need to happen as soon as possible, or we may yet lose some key and iconic venues.
Yeah, absolutely right, Steve. I mean, I think I absolutely agree with Damien there. A watershed moment is exactly what this is. This is a real opportunity for government. It's a real opportunity for the arts councils and the cultural sector. And it's a huge opportunity for the music industry itself. You know, we've created something called the Pipeline Investment Fund Group. We've got very good responses from the music industry already. But we need actual action. You know, we need to turn that into action. I mean, I regularly deal with venues that are closing down because they can't afford £1,000 to play a solicitor. Mm. And that's just got to be unacceptable. In a £4.5 billion industry, we must be able to get the support that these venues need. We must be able to make them fantastic places to play, great places to be in. You know, that's been my entire life in these venues. Everybody I know, you included, you know, we love these venues. The community needs these venues. We can do something about this. And I think the watershed moment is, let's take action. Let's not just read the report, all nod our heads and agree with it. Let's actually do something.
You do sound like you've finally found somebody. I know, I think everyone in who runs a grassroots venue or promotes just felt the feeling, and this is something we pointed out a few years ago, that just no one understood what it entailed to run gigs at this level, how hard it was, the fact that we, you know, people were doing it and still are very much doing it, not for profit, but just for the love of it. But suddenly someone is beginning to understand what the value in the grassroots live music circuit.
Couldn't agree more, Steve. I think that's the big... a big tribute I'd like to pay to the people who've done this report, to Damien and all the committee members. I think they've really listened, not just to us. You know, I know we shout a lot, but they've listened to the artists. They've really thought about the way that the music industry works. They've thought about the division of cultural money. I mean, you know, 0.06% of the money that we give out for public funding of arts is currently going into these venues. 0.06%. It's not good enough, you know. All of these venues right the way across the country could survive on just the money that the Royal Opera House gets.
I would say,
we just need to have a think about it, you know. And that's not to knock opera. It's just, let's get this under control, you know. And this report has got meaningful actions that people can take, and we hope they're actually going to take them.
But mention this in passing, but surely as well, it's the live music industry or the music industry. It's not just a government responsibility to prop up the live music circuit, is it? Someone somewhere who's making the money out of the bands who used to play at the Southampton Joiners and learnt their craft playing small venues, someone in the music industry, surely it's also, it is a business after all. Shouldn't they be helping to fund the next wave of talent?
Yeah, I mean, this is the place where research and development is going on, and it's going on in a kind of weird, gambly sort of way, you know, where people are putting on bands, they just happen to like giving them time to play. They're not expecting to make any money out of them. But 25, 30 years later, those are the bands that we all talk about and we all think about when we think about Brand Britain. Oasis, as you said, one of our events, Oasis played 25 shows on this circuit, and you said 2 years ago, only 12 of them are left. I've got bad news for you, Steve. Only 10 of them are left. You know, that's how many Oasis are we going to lose that don't get their first chance to play?
Yeah.
So I think it's something we really need to be on top of. There's so much, there's so many opportunities here to do something positive. We could do something with small amounts of money coming from biggest shows. We can do something with small amounts of donations. You know, Damien mentioned the production tax credit. That's a really useful opportunity for the bigger companies to put some money into the smaller venues under a tax credit system. Honestly, this is a real watershed moment, but it requires action.
And Mr. Collins, I should mention, Damien, that this report, it's not just about small venues. It covers so much more. It's a much broader report about live music. It also addresses issues regarding various other aspects of live music, including, I'm conscious we're running out of time. We don't have a lot of time to talk about this, but you did dig away into secondary, I mean, this is of interest to Six Music listeners, I'm sure, secondary ticket sales and how that's impacting on the live music industry.
Well, that's right. And this is the sort of second look we've had at the secondary ticketing market in the last couple of years. A couple of years ago, we sort of campaigned within Parliament for the government to change the law to ban the use of bots to harvest vast quantities of tickets when they first go on sale, so the fans never get the chance to buy them at the real face value. They only get the chance to buy them through the secondary market where the agents resell them. So the law was changed to ban that practice. But the other thing that we've really pushed in this report is that there are still some sites, Viagogo being one that we particularly call out, which are not selling tickets in compliance with the consumer protection law that says that it should be really clear when you buy a ticket from a site, where the ticket is in the venue, if it's got a seat or a block number, and also whether there were any restrictions on resale, because you could turn up at the venue having spent a huge amount on this ticket and find you can't get in, and that, you know, that information is not always provided. So, you know, we said in the case of Viagogo, until the authorities are happy they're complying with the law, it is too risky to buy a ticket from them. Don't buy a ticket from them. But I think there is still a problem here, which is that, you know, fans find it difficult to get hold of tickets at their face value, and they're concerned that they're being ripped off when they try and buy them from an agent or a tout on the secondary market.
I'm sure there's a lot more lobbying to come, but the report itself does, as I say, covers a lot of grounds. Are you optimistic you can bring some of these things to fruition?
Yes, I am, actually. I think we've put forward what we thought, you know, were sensible, practical ideas that we think are deliverable and that could make a difference, that we certainly feel respond to what we were told by people from the industry and from the grassroots of the industry when they gave evidence to us. The formal process is the government has to give a response in writing to each of the recommendations that we've made, which we'll be publishing that in due course as well. And so I hope the government take on board some of these recommendations and we'll then have a plan of action.
I'm sure you can find the report online. It's well worth a read.